Today's festivities are accompanied by Little Brown Jug's Black Lager. They describe it as having a light roast malt flavor, dark color, and herbal and malty aroma with a clean, crisp finish. Do you remember these wireless microphones that I got in a mailbag a few weeks back? You know, the ones that I discovered after I bought them are actually illegal to use in Canada and actually anywhere in North America because of the frequency that they operate on. So wireless microphones operating in this frequency range in the lower 600 megahertz have been illegal in North America for about 2 years, and it was announced about 5 years before that it was coming. Unfortunately, this seller didn't get the message, and I failed to check before I ordered them, so here we go. On the upside, the seller, after I contacted him and linked him to the Industry Canada webpage, I said, and the FCC webpage, he agreed to refund me and told me to dispose of these locally, which I shall do in the form of a teardown. So this set came with two transmitters, one receiver, and apparently both transmitters can transmit to this one at the same time, which is kind of cool. It came with a 4-pin 3.5 millimeter cable, 3-pin to 4-pin, and two charging cables. These are kind of cool. I haven't encountered this kind of charging cables before. They're one USB-A to dual USB-C. There's two of those, and there's three of these things, so that works out well. But these guys themselves, as I said, operate in illegal frequencies. So here I've got my spectrum analyzer software running with my SDR connected up to my tablet. And I power this guy on. It comes up in the 638 megahertz range. That's well within the forbidden zone. But this other one seems to want to be at around 613.5. See that? So this guy, if it stays put, I think is actually legal. Well, this may not be such a bad thing after all. Okay, cool. So I am going to set this one aside and not destroy it during the teardown. This one, however, that seems to want to be at the higher frequency, that is going to be our victim. And if I can figure out how to open it up in a reversible manner, then we'll also take a look inside the receiver. Let me just clear the deck here. So let's see how we get into this thing. I'm not seeing any screw holes anywhere. Nothing hiding under the clip. It's a fairly good spring on that clip. Got a USB-C and a little LED on the bottom here. Got a microphone input, an auxiliary input, and a built-in microphone there. Power button, set button, volume plus and minus. That set button, you push it at the same time as... What does it say? Okay, so you push the set button at the same time as you're powering it on, and that tells the receiver what channel or to lock onto it, I guess. Okay. And apparently using the set button will also cause it to change frequencies. But if I have to repair them each time I turn them on, and I don't know if I do, but if I do, then there is the potential for them to wander off into danger zone. So that still seems kind of risky to me. Anyway, let's grab a spudger, I guess, since I can't see any screws, and scratch the plastic. Cool. Can I get in around the... Oh, hey, I can get in underneath there. That's neat. But what happens? Ooh, that sounded adhesive. Is that it? Was it really just stuck onto the face of those chips and the lip around the edge of the case? Huh, that's not very secure. Okay. Anyway, what can we see inside here? We have a microphone right up there, just a standard little electret microphone capsule. We got a couple of chips, some transistors or other three terminal devices, the push buttons over there. 1B, 2AB. I'm not sure what that is, but we'll figure it out later. Let's dive a little bit deeper. if I decide that this isn't safe to use, if I can't be assured that it's going to stay on the channels that I put it on, then at the very least, I guess I can salvage the battery out of it. Why won't you lift? I'm trying to be a little bit careful because there is a battery underneath there. It's probably lithium ion. Oh, okay. This pops up. So there we have just the little push buttons on the side, and they make contact with these little tactile switches. Okay. Two connectors there. We have an antenna. We have the battery or cell. It feels nice and firm, not puffy at all, but it is glued down or taped down or stuck down. So we can't see how big it is. And it does have some little divots in it. It's been pushing up against the case. So that's a little concerning. Let's grab a non-conductive spudger and just gently. Okay, well, programming header on this side. And the battery is a 400 milliamp hour, 3.7 volt, 1.48 watt hour lithium ion battery. All right, there is a little protection board on the end of that battery. That's nice. So about all that's left to look at is these two chips on this side. And I suppose I could trace the wiring. So there is the antenna lead up there. There is a little matching circuit there. Crystal, main chip, KT0641. Okay. So that looks like it connects up to the RF stuff in that corner. I could only really find one website that had any reference to these things at all. And I have to use a janky translation, but it looks like it is some sort of an USB audio RF kind of a chip with an analog to digital converter in it and all kinds of stuff like that, if this thing is translating correctly. Then there's this guy, which is completely anonymous. Since that was so easy to take apart, let's dive into the receiver and see just how different it is. I'm going to guess it has the same chips and everything in it. Or maybe a complementary chip. We'll see. So it went in just in right there. Yeah, and that's working again here. Keep those separate. Oh, it's got more differenter chips in it. I guess that makes sense. I suppose we'll see what's on the other side, but I'm going to guess that it's probably just the battery again and the connectors. But there's only one way to find out. Yep, battery and connectors and an antenna and nothing else. Okay. So what is these little chippy chips here? So that one is a KT0651, which sounds very much like it should be the complement to the 641 on that board, doesn't it? And there's actually two of them. So those, without looking them up, I'm going to guess that those are the two RF chips, the two receiver chips. And the 641 on the transmitter board is actually the RF part there, the transmitter. What else do we have? PT24C128A. Is that the same chip? Yeah. No, it's Morgan. FT. Yeah, FT. Okay. And there's two of those as well. Maybe audio chips? Guessing? I don't know. I'll look them up in a second. Then there's this guy, ESMT, not sure who that manufacturer is, ED22650. No idea. Any guesses? Only one way to find out, and that's to go to the computer and look. So the other two chips on the receiver are both two-wire serial EEPROMs. I guess that makes a certain amount of sense. Although initially I thought they were some sort of an audio interface, but it seems like those other chips do 90% of that stuff all on their own. So there we go. Ah, so that final chip on the receiver is the audio chip. Okay. So it must take audio from the two RF chips and amplify and process it, I assume. The only question I have is it being used for the monitoring headphone output or to drive the line level that goes out to your recording device? Yeah, their specs show it going into a 16 ohm mode, so that's definitely being used as a headphone amplifier. Okay. So it seems that that is the majority of what we need to know about these things. I am going to throw them back together and let's just see how it sounds. That's always a useful thing. And since I think I can trust the other one to operate on a frequency that's not going to get me in trouble with, you know, Industry Canada or my actual employer for interfering with the world, then I think I should be safe to do that test. Just toss this back together and I'll be right back. Little Sony Pocket digital recorder here on the microphone input, and we will see what we get. Now, I can't guarantee that that's going to be good, but well, I guess we'll just have to find out. So turn the receiver on, turn the transmitter on. We have RF lights and they both changed. This thing before, when I didn't have the receiver turned on, its RF light was staying blue. Now it's turned red. So I think if I record here, instead of hold this kind of in the general direction of my head, hopefully we should get some recorded audio on here. And if we are getting recorded audio on here, that's what you will be listening to right now. Okay, so if this is now working properly the way I think it is, you should be listening to the wireless microphone connected directly into my Samsung that I'm using for a camera here, which is sort of how this thing's designed to be used. I've got the microphone pretty much spaced the same distance from my mouth as my phone is when I'm normally doing these videos. I'm also listening to the receiver through headphones, and it sounds, I'd call it a little brittle or something like that. But the other thing, there's tons of handling noise on this thing, which is really, really annoying and not at all performance. Not happy with that. But now I'm going to connect this and put it up close to where I would normally wear this microphone. And in my earphones, that sounds better, actually. That's odd. And of course, I don't have the handling noise from this thing either, so that might be a win, just to use a lav mic instead of using this as a lav mic, because wow, is that ever sensitive. So that was interesting. If I can trust this thing to stay on a friendly frequency, on a friendly channel, then life should be good. But I don't like all that handling noise. That is just ridiculous. So I suppose if I can use it with a headset mic or with a clip-on lav mic or something, if I can get one that's a little bit less shoddy than what I've got. So the problem isn't that I'm mechanically touching the microphone capsule, it's that the microphone capsule is hearing any contact with this thing, with this case. So I don't know how you'd go about remedying that, quite honestly. Maybe wrap the entire body pack completely in foam or cloth or something so that it can't be rubbed or contacted. I don't know. Not super impressed with that. I wonder how the Rode microphones get around that. Because as I mentioned in the mailbag video where these things first showed up, these things are basically just trying to look like a clone of a Rode, was it Rode Go 2, I think it's called, something like that. Microphone, which is a several hundred dollar microphone, and that this set was, I think, less than $50. So I don't know. Is it worth the money? No. And if you live in North America, don't buy it. If you live anywhere else, before buying any wireless microphone, always check what frequencies it runs on and what frequencies are legal in your country. I may just use this as a source of a couple of cells since the guy did refund it. I don't know. What do you think? I'm hoping that you heard demos of this in here properly. I'm not super impressed with what I was hearing through my monitoring headphones, but yeah, it actually did sound better when I was using the old headset microphone instead of when I was using the built-in microphone. Anyway, questions or comments down below. Thanks for watching, as always. I will talk to you later.